All right, hello and welcome to another episode of the Bradford City Career Mode. We're off the back of a very good match. Unfortunately, the very good match didn't take place in the Premier League. It took place in the Carabao Cup over Sheffield Wednesday. And we got the 4-0 win over them, which is incredible in my personal opinion. But it's just how it goes that we can't do that in the Premier League right now. Hopefully, we can replicate something like that against Aston Villa, or at least get some points against Aston Villa, because look at us right now, we're in 17th and we should be aiming for top four. I know we're only three games in, but that's still not excusable, really. We're going to return the squad to its former state, and actually, I'm going to try something here. We're going to try something completely different. Never mind, no, we're not. I don't think I. Wait, can. Where can Dembele play? Left wing, right wing. Sancho, right mid, left mid. Jota, centre forward, left wing. So if I do this, and then that, it's just back to our normal squad. But I was wanting to maybe move Greenwood a bit further up. But I suppose I'd have to bring off a really good player in order to do that. I thought Militao was away on international duty. But I guess he isn't. Carbonero is, so I don't know how that explains that. But anyway, Nazpol's going to get a seat on the bench for a bit. I'm also going to give O'Leary one as well, because Martensen's kind of buggered. We're going to switch that around. I might bring Yartsev up pretty soon, especially if Hakimi gets too tired. For right back, we could use Militao, possibly, if we don't want to use Hill yet. But we might have to bring up someone for the left back spot. But anyway, that's not the point. The point is right now, we just need to not lose again, because that would be awful. Anyway, let's take a look at the news before we go into this match against Aston Villa. Haaland scores a brace as Bradford grab win over Sheffield Wednesday. Haaland scores to put his name on the score sheet for Bradford City in their 4-0 win against Sheffield Wednesday. Thank God we got through that. I don't know if we've figured out who we face next in the Carabao Cup. Thank you, Miller, for the, whatchamacallit, the sparks, the 1,000 sparks. We need to get going sooner rather than later, though, in the Premier League. And I am loading up the tables again, but it's taking a while because we're six seasons in. I don't know how much this career mode can function beyond, like, three seasons. But anyway, we'll go here and see if we've got our next round to the Carabao Cup. It might not yet. There might be replays. Although we have. Oh. Of course we're against Southampton. There's so many easy teams we could have got there. Bristol, QPR, Charlton, Peterborough, Swansea maybe. Hell, Burnley might have been easy in comparison. Scunthorpe perhaps. Or even, I don't know, Salford, Portsmouth, Barnsley, Blackburn or Reading, or even Huddersfield. They're doing bad in the Premier League, so they probably would have been a walkover. But no, we get one of our teams that we can't seem to beat, and one of the most improved teams in this career mode. We get Southampton. Bloody Christ. Anyway, alright, we're going to go into the Villa game now because I've been talking long enough and the squad is how I want it. So, let's see what we can do. I don't expect any miracles. There hasn't been any so far in this Premier League season. We've got a hell of a team. I'm going to put Lafont back as well. I forgot to do that. A hell of a team and I just can't seem to be able to do anything with them in the Premier League, which sucks. Thank you for the 5,000 sparks as well, Miller. Appreciate it. Lafont in goal, Hakimi and Wan-Bissaka as the fullbacks, Militao and Upamecano as the centre backs, Dembele left mid, Sancho right mid, Tielemans and Greenwood centre mid, Jota centre forward, and Hloszczyk striker. Realistically, this team should tear apart any team in the Premier League, but it doesn't at the moment, and I don't know why. Anyway, we're going to go into it and see how we do against Aston Villa. I think a big reason why is because Lafont couldn't goalkeep his way out of a, which I think of a funny saying, but I can't think of anything. But basically, Lafont can't save anything at the moment. That was evident in the match against Brighton. But maybe now he's had a little break. He can recover, recuperate, rest, get back into it. Has FIFA crashed? No, it's just taken longer to load everything. Okay, got it. Sancho's banged it to her. Sancho hasn't banged it, to be fair. Sancho's banged it again, to be fair. Okay, whatever. And we go to Villa Park, where Aston Villa will be the hosts of today's game against Bradford City.
This is the scene at Villa Park. I'm Derek Ray, and with me in the commentary position is the former Arsenal and England fullback Lee Dixon. And we've got Premier League.
Please, can we get a win here? I don't care how it is. If it's like 5-4 or something, if we win 5-4, I don't care. I just want 3 points in this career mode. We need to kickstart the season sooner rather than later if we're going to aim for top four. We're now at 17th, 3 games gone. And I know it's 3 games, but I need to stress the fact that this team is underperforming. Plushek with 4 goals in the last 3 matches, which is fair enough. He's got 2 in the Premier League so far. Well, and he got 1 in the Carabao Cup, so that's 3. I'm trying to think where the 4th came from. Really hard to stop the, I don't know, but anyway, hopefully he's on top form today, banging him in the back of the net. But we need to be as strong in defence as we are in offence. Ivanildo Fernandez, that's a hell of a long name. I don't know how they managed to fit that on the t-shirt. Try to see if I can recognise anyone. Got a few names I don't recognise there. El Ghazi still at Aston Villa. I don't know if he was at Aston Villa to start the career mode, actually. But I've seen him there in the Aston Villa team before. Let's see who they're playing then. They've got Kalinic in goal. Mulder, Konsa, Fernandez and Mings. Mings playing left-back. Interesting choice there. Jensen, Nakamba and Fossum. And then Van Bergen, Loder and El Ghazi. I've not heard of half of those players, which probably means they're going to tear my asshole open. They've got quite a few players on the bench as well who I recognise. John McGinn. Courtney House as well. But we've got Lafont in goal, Wan-Bissaka, Upamecano, Militao and Hakimi, Greenwood and Yuri, Sancho, Jota and Dembele and Hloszczyk. This team should destroy. But for some reason it doesn't. Pass the Villa, kick it off at Villa Park anyway, and hopefully we can get something out of this one. Bit pressure on him, maybe, and that'll give the ball away. Wan-Bissaka wins it back. Tielemans. It's not the best decision making for me there. Maybe I'm starting to understand why I'm not getting as much luck in the Premier League. Lafont's actually saved something. That could have been disastrous, though. But one thing I've noticed as well is I panic spam LB to try and get it to the right player, and then I get to the right player, and then I go past the right player as well, so. Maybe need to try and get out of the practice of that. Lost it through to Jota, but he's led it through and it's not worked out for us. I was hoping maybe that would work. Didn't, obviously. Yuri, winning the ball back. Out to Dembele. Into Diogo Jota. Greenwood. There's so many Villa players ready to intercept it. Hakimi. Fucking please, just make the pass properly. Don't fucking give it a half-ass pass there. That's not what we need in the middle of an attack. Greenwood. Can you send Hloszczyk through? Nope. Of course he can't. He's always got the... What's if Mikano's done? Militao has just cleaned up for once. It's the first time I think he's actually done a good job. Like the, oh, or at least a thing like that. But what Greenwood. The fuck happened there with Mikano? And how the... I'm just getting bodied every fucking time, bro. Could be a yellow for the Aston Villa player, but I'm sick of being fucking bodied. Nakamba. Oh, what? Hold up a minute. Wait a minute. He got the ball. I did get outstrengthed, but okay. I mean, that can make things easier.
Greenwood.
Sancho.
Can he deliver accurately?
Hloszczyk somehow got the ball out of this. I don't know
how. And Goodison Park. Let's get details.
John Lee still got the ball.
It's a goal for Everton.
Greenwood blocked. Very good block as well from the Villa defender. It could have all gone wrong there. I'm not sure which Villa defender got the block in, but he's got the block. Number 15. I'm a little bit confused there how the cam has been sent off. I don't mind because it gives us an advantage, definitely. But I need to take advantage of that advantage for it to mean anything. Yuri towards Jota. Comes to Greenwood. Yuri. Close near post. I just immediately press B. But my guy decides to take a touch. So if he doesn't take a touch, that's probably 1-0. I immediately press B though. As soon as I got that ball. Van Bergen tried to run through now. It's not going to work that easily. Well, maybe it might. I don't know. Hakimi is intercept here, and he hasn't done.
Possession and patience, the watchwords.
It's crossed towards the back post to El Ghazi, who will pick up the ball here. Probably not what Aston Villa were looking for in that exchange.
Good tackle.
That's so annoying when they just keep turning and turning and wasting fucking time. Now Greenwood's got a bit of space to work here. And we know he's got a bit of pace to burn as well.
Good looking sequence.
Of course, it doesn't work out. No, it's going to be a goal kick, because of course it is. But we are making... I'm trying to think of positives, to be honest. We are making chances, or at least danger... Like, we're... I don't know. I'm trying to think of something positive. We're pushing forward, I guess. Like, would that be a good one? We're pushing forward.
And this is Diogo Jota now.
Dembele. I just can't seem to ever get that last pass through when I need to. And then when I do, I get tackled.
Pressing at its best.
Jota. Boy, that's got Sancho, but it's now gone to Sancho. Penalty? No? Okay, headset's messing up. Nice. I mean, not the penalty, I just wanted to see if it could have been. I'm aware it wasn't going to be a penalty. Wan-Bissaka, Mecano, gone to Tielemans. Hakimi now. Back to Tielemans. Jota.
This could be an interesting avenue.
Brutal loss check. And that's not a penalty either.
And offside is the
decision. Oh, you've got to be fucking my ass, bro. Well, yeah, he didn't, Elias with loss check, I don't think he even got, maybe did. Got that right. I don't know. And then, fucking, that counts as offside. We're struggling against a 10-man Aston Villa. Goodness knows how we're going to fucking cope in the Premier, in the Champions League, I should say. Passes don't go through far enough from 90 rated players who should be passing that through with no issue. Apparently having issues passing it through. Which makes absolutely no sense really, but so it goes.
Tyrone Mings.
Yeah, their players can just pass it around me like fucking no problem. Easy save for Lafont though, however.
Well, Derek, neither side Hakimi. Has done enough in this game. There's a lack of quality.
Dembele.
All around. It really has been a poor
Mulder's
game.
Going to catch up with me.
There's
fucking
still
kidding
time
me.
Left. Can somebody be the
ball
hero?
Check. I got to not get body blocked there. What, does the referee not understand that body blocking is just not a thing that you're meant to do in football? Is that what the referee's like, oh, body blocking's fine. I'm sorry for the heavy breathe on the mic there, if you could hear that, but... Oh, the quality's gone shit. Nice. Nice. The quality's gone to garbage. Beautiful. I have to reset this one.
Now Eder Militao.
Jota.
Diogo Jota.
Can't hold out forever. Could someone go through? No? Okay, I guess I'll just go for a meal.
Can they take the lead? Not the easiest
almost.
Of situations for the keeper.
Probably fix itself yet? Nope. If it's not fixed by half time, I'll probably reset the episode. Still one's been awful quality. I don't know why it's even possibly going to be an awful quality because I'm the only one using the bloody internet. Is it fixed itself? Not yet. Corner though.
Corner kick played over.
Sancho couldn't quite get the header on it. It's cleared away. And oh boy, is it cleared away. Of course it's going to go straight to their fucking player when I've got nobody back. Why wouldn't it? Like, what are the odds of it actually just got my players for once? They could have a hell of a counter attack on here. Wan-Bissaka, please. I'm not...
Dangerous looking attack. He must finish. And it is the opening goal of the contest.
Well, it was always going to be a tight game, but now all of a sudden, one team ahead. Things have got to change on both sides. Well, so much has gone against them in this game. But wow, have they dug just, in and they've got their...
What am I doing wrong in the Premier League that's going, like... That goal, shall we? This is fucking us over. Besides Lafont being an absolute fucking idiot.
Well, I've never seen a worse goalkeeper in the career modes. So
I've watched a couple of career modes on YouTube. I don't think I've seen a worse goalkeeper than the one I've got. So what do you know? I think the quality is just going to fix itself then and there. That's surprising, that. That's actually surprising that as soon as they score, the quality's like, oh, actually, we'll be okay again now. Yeah, fuck this game. So that's the message I've got today. The referee has indicated they mentioned playing four at the back. They've got fucking seven. 3 minutes. I can't pick out that run because it'll just get cut off, and I can't get around this guy. Oh, bro. Oh,
goodness, he was right on top. What can I do?
I can't do anything. I can't break through a defence. I'm gonna have a mental breakdown with this career mode. I don't know how to attack with this team. I don't know how to beat defences. We're at the end of 45 minutes in this game. We're 1-0 down. How are we fucking 1-0 down, bro? I'm gonna lose it. For this team too. They desperately need him. Just need to relax. Not being much help. Think about why Lafont is throwing games. Right. 1-0 to Bournemouth over Chelsea, 2-0 to Everton over Leicester, 2-0 to Southampton over Newcastle, Liverpool and Spurs drawing 0-0, Watford and Brighton drawing 0-0, and West Ham and Man City are yet to play. Four shots to three on target for both teams, only they've got a goal, 56% possession and 44% possession for them. Of course they get the fucking breakthrough, and then once the breakthrough happens, the quality fixes itself. I pressed A. And now the second half. Jesus Christ, I'm having a meltdown. I must have fat fingered and pressed B, to be honest, but I wanted to press A there. It was not, B was not the option there to press.
They're winning this game. They're sucking their opponents onto them, and with the pace they've got in midfield and up front,
I'm going to lose it with some of my players. They're meant to be fucking good players and they're just dog shit. Space and time for the cross. Dembele. All right, Dembele should be absolutely outpacing Mulder here. What the fuck is that then? Mulder has 99 pace, like, or 105 pace or something. I don't know. He's got more than Dembele somehow. Offside against Villa. What is different about the Premier League this season than what it was last season? Besides the fact that I can't be fucking shit past the defence. Every defence is just upgraded and... Even maybe they're not upgraded the players, but they're just upgraded.
And don't forget we have more Premier League action coming up for you.
I even want to play the Premier League this season. Can I? Is there an opt-out option that's offside because of slight bit? It'll be the slightest margin.
Oh, I'm not so sure. I'd like
maybe
to
not.
See that again.
I tried to pass it earlier. Bit of hesitation off the pass there, of course. If Meccano wins a header. And don't forget we have more Premier I don't know how to break through a defence on FIFA 20 on career mode in the Premier League in Season 6. Taking on Watford. Yeah, that looks a great match. Dude, I think I'm about to just cut all like wide passes out of my game plan because every time I try and get a good attack going and a wide pass is ready to be played, it's actually not ready to be played. It's ready to be fucking intercepted because it's too heavy. Bro, I don't know if I can be bloody arsed. I don't know how I'm meant to win. I don't know if there is a winning option in this game. El Ghazi coming off for Claude Maurice. I actually need someone to fucking tell me what I'm doing wrong because I have no clue. Sancho's getting tackled, no problem. He's meant to be a world beater probably at this point in career mode. And he's getting tackled, no problem. And a goal to tell you about. I think the problem is with every career mode team right now. Yeah, no, I can't deal. I can't play this. I can't actually play this. I just want to do a simple pass. And even that travels too fucking far. But then they could just like thread every pass together as if the Barcelona. I tackle, don't get the ball back. Militar actually does eventually get the ball back. Maybe I do a pass. But even they don't work because Tielemans is a touch of a fucking dead seagull. Half an hour remaining then. I can't play this. I just can't play this. This is fucking dreadful. And here is Mings.
looking for the right moment for that final pass.
I'm against a 10-man Aston Villa and I'm losing. What the fuck am I actually doing wrong? Dembele, please, I beg. Give me some salvation. Fucking thank you, you French magician. Oh my god, a break. We actually got a break. We've actually got sub luck on our side. Dembele making a run and a half through.
Absolutely brilliant. One key ingredient.
And it's a goal. If that had gone wide, I think I might have actually just had a meltdown or hit the post or anything. If that had not gone into the back of the net, I think I might have had a meltdown. More than what I've had already this season. Now, can we please, with 26 minutes left, can we please actually get 3 points on the fucking board in the Premier League? Probably not. They're probably going to score a second because Lafont does not a goalkeep. But I have hope. They've got 10 men, but you wouldn't know it. Nakamba got sent off in like the 10th minute or the 11th minute or something. And we've had absolutely nothing to take advantage. Jota, thank you. Responding eventually. A really slow computer program. Sancho. Back into Jota. Brutal Hloszczyk. Try to get back into Jota, but I'm getting bodied every fucking time I try and do something. Fossum coming off. From McGinn. I swear, if Aston Villa win this match, I actually think I might just take a little break from this career mode. There's really so much of this game I could take. If Meccano doesn't win the header, Sancho probably won't win possession here. Oh no, he does, fair enough. Sancho.
Tielemans.
Out to Wan-Bissaka.
Targets to aim at.
Looks like he had to go straight at Kalinic. Aston Villa fans will be wanting a win after they've been fucking dominating me today, but they won't get it, hopefully. So what is that then? Why does it do that? Can I get a little info on why I try and turn my player and he just touches it to the other side of the fucking Atlantic? Maybe. Dembele, please. Thank you! Oh, I thought I'd saved it. Dembele is a lifesaver. And no wonder he's enjoying himself. Here's the replay, and I can see why the keeper's a little frustrated. He thought he got enough. I want to make fucking substitutions, but A, I don't want to fuck this up and lose. And B, we've got a 2-8 break after this anyway. How's Kalinic not saved that? Goalkeepers in this game are AIDS. Changed my mind. Like, not just mine. Goalkeeping in general. I don't know what the coding is on them, but obviously the answer to the coding question is not good. But 2-1 now. Well, fucking please, don't make me cry by equalising. Jota. That tackle's been attempted there, Sancho. Oh shit. I'd say it's 2-1, but they were talking about another match. Jota. Of course, my player can't make space just for a chance there, but I would be able to. It's only his job, or, you know. Offside, luckily. Danny Loder coming off for Russian Hepburn Murphy. We've finally taken advantage of the fact that they've been at 10 men for the entire game.
Greenwood. And the poor touch didn't help them on the possession front.
Of course the poor touch didn't help him because I don't know what the fuck he's taking that touch for, but luckily it's gone off the pitch. Hopefully they can just fuck it up for the last 10 minutes. I don't even care, like I said at the start, I don't care what the scoreline is as long as we get 3 points somewhere. I don't know why we're struggling against teams we should be beating, no problem, but we are. Maybe we just need to get back into the rhythm of it. I don't know what we need to get back into the rhythm of, but maybe it. Maybe we just need to change the formation again. Every player on this team seems to just be faster than every player on my team right now. I don't know if that's a new perk. Hloszczyk, I don't know what you fucking want me to do there when you're touching it like a fucking dead animal. Surely they'll get another chance or two.
Fruitful looking attack.
Of course, the keeper's out of position.
In position here to protect the ball.
Dembele gets a block in. Not Dembele. Could go here. Could go. Could go. If he wasn't fouled. The referee's not going to give anything for it, though. So that's fine. Realistically, though, Dembele shouldn't be caught up with there. Yeah, I'm just going to pass it back to the keeper and LB next it, because I don't trust this game. I don't care if he's back in their possession as long as it's away from my goal. Wan-Bissaka. Sancho. How are they finding it so easy to stop my players? I know they didn't do it on that occasion, but like in general, I don't know what I'm doing wrong. There's, I think that's a striker that's just cut all the way back there to defend. Bosic shot blocked by Fernandez. You better think twice if you need to fucking score an equaliser. We almost lost to 10-man Aston Villa.
Dembele.
I hope something big happens in a deadline day so I don't have to title it anything in relation to the game, because this game has just been so fucking stupid. We finally get our first Premier League win. It's been long enough. It should have happened on day one, but it's happened on day four. Villa losing the 1-0 lead thanks to Ousmane Dembele being the bloody hero today. The only one with enough of a brain to take advantage of Villa having 10 men.
Nice and cool. He didn't do that, and he's cost his team today. He really has.
I thought Nakamba sending off wouldn't matter at one point, and I thought maybe I'd have to reset the episode because the quality had gone to shit. But as soon as they went ahead just before half time, the quality fixed itself, which isn't surprising. But in the end of the day, Dembele gets a double to save us from another embarrassing defeat. Fucking Christ almighty on a bike. 7 shots to 6 on target, 55% possession for us. 4 shots to 3 on target, 45% possession for them. They didn't even have a shot in the second half. If we'd drawn, I would have been really mad. There's my Dembele man of the match. Not even contested, to be honest. Tielemans getting 8.6, though. 8.0 for Jota as well. Hoshik was 6.9. Didn't put any performance in today. Did they hit the post in the first half, though, to be fair. Militao the better of the centre-back. Super Meccano was constantly caught out today in the wrong position. Reading the balls wrong. I don't know what's going on there, but it doesn't matter because we got the win. Bournemouth beat Chelsea.
And
that's a weird... that's all I could read before the scoreboard went, but that's a weird result to see. With 2 goals to secure a win, Dembele was a hero today. Any thoughts? Thank fuck for him, because we would have been fucked otherwise. Impressive performance from Dembele. The rest of the team can fuck off. I'm very impressed with the way Dembele played today. It was a world-class performance. To be honest, I have thought about bringing Carbonero on for Dembele, but I'm glad I didn't. You managed to win a close match with a decisive goal in the second half. What do you think made the difference in today's game? We were the better team. I think we deserved to win based on how we played. We created enough chances, the score could have been bigger. But for some reason, it wasn't. You only won by one goal. Was Aston Villa an opponent widely considered weaker, difficult to beat in the end? For some reason, yes. But every match is difficult. Every match is difficult. We take nothing for granted. We give our all in each and every match, regardless of who we're lining up against. I can tell you firsthand that every match is difficult, because games you should be winning, you're losing. Games you should be losing, you're not losing. It's just a weird thing. But anyway, that's the end of the games. I'll probably be another 10 or 15 minutes for the end of the episode because it is deadline day. After all the deals have gone through, of course, we will be going through the biggest deals of the window. Let's see our deals so far. We've sold quite a few players, but we brought in only one. Will we sell any more players? Maybe bring in a big signing? Let's see. We count down the hours. See, we've got a message here before Haaland. I'm low-key wanting to sell him because I don't know how much more he's going to grow, but I don't want to sell him to a Premier League team. Maybe should have sold him to the no, it's not happening, pretty much is what I'm trying to say here. Like, I will sell him if it's not to a Premier League team and it is for good money, and I've got enough time to sign someone else, of course, as well. Anyway, I don't think anything's going to happen either way for us or against us, to be honest. I could be wrong. Game proved me wrong. Oh, there's a message. Who's it for? for Haaland once again. I did say Atletico Madrid that if you give me a good offer, then you can maybe have him, but I don't know how much more I can really ask for, to be honest. And I don't want to sell him. Nah, I've changed my mind. I'm sorry. Well, I know what I said, but like, I just don't want to sell him because he does score a lot of goals. Whether he's a high overall or a low overall, he has good performances or bad performances. He does score a lot of goals in the end. I know I said I was going to sell him to possibly a team from outside of the Premier League, but I just don't want to. Pretty much. Right, so 1 hour left. Loan offer for Grinkov. It's not going to be completed in time, which means we've got to stick with this cunt for another bloody 6 months. Why did they offer in the last hour? This won't go through now till the next one, probably. September is what I'm looking for. But anyway, we'll sum up to the next game and then we'll go over all the deadline day deals and all the deals of the window. Transfer deadline day has ended. Please tell me Grinkov's actually gone. Youth Squad Monthly Report, Yartsev, still looking fine. I think it's honestly time to bring him up. Now we just need to wait. Oh, the fucking loan move broke down. Ugh. I will never be rid of Grinkov. Anyway, we'll do some training. Let's try and get Yartsev immediately to 72 here so we can go in the squad report and see he's grown by an overall. I'm going to also check something after this as well. I don't know why I want to. I don't really know why I want to look at it, but for just because I'm nosy kind of thing. I want to look. I won't spoil it, but you guys can maybe guess. You guys could take a guess anyway. If you get it right or wrong is a different matter. Tillman's is close to 89, you know. And hopefully that win against Aston Villa starts a fire inside of us, and hopefully that fire rumbles on. But we are against Watford next, and they were a bogey team last season, so I don't know what to expect. But anyway, there we go. Training's done. We'll get another drill as well before the Watford game, so maybe we can hit Anisimov up to an 88. And once Anisimov gets to an 80, if he does get to an 80, he'll be in good contention for possibly a bench spot. Yep, show me absolutely nothing, thank you. Didn't even make it to a billion with the total spent. I don't know what to title this episode. Obviously, you'll see what title is once I get there, but Finland want to have me for an international management. Why is it that I've done so well with this club, and I don't think I've got one big team coming for an international management offer? Like, I don't know if I would accept it or reject it regardless, but it's not. It's the principle of the thing. I've been in Bradford for 5 seasons now, gone on to my 6th season, and have absolutely... Wait, Yartsev have got picked? He didn't tell me he got picked, maybe because I brought him up. Right, whatever, I'll give Martinson a big helping hand. I'll try to give him some sort of helping hand anyway. Anisimov could go to 78 here. Just needs to actually get some semblance of a good result for his sprint speed here. And Hill, we'll give him a little bit more. We need him to get going. He's 75 now. We need him to keep going along that trail. Don't know what a trend beyond that. I suppose Grinkov can get a bit. I don't really see him. I don't know how he's still here. I don't know how Laganov's still here either. Please tell me they're coming to the end of their contracts. No offense to them, but I just don't want them here. The only reason I'm giving them drills now is because I've literally got nobody else to give drills to. I'm not even going to give one to Laganov. Try and give another one to Hill, I guess. Try and get his defensive stats up. Anisimov makes it to a 78. Hill with an A as well. Going quite well there. Hopefully the progress will continue. As it is doing. Martinson could have done a bit better and hit 76 there. But it's neither here nor there. But like I said, last season Watford was our bogey team, so to speak. Hennessy's asking for a start. We'll see. I've been in pretty good form lately. I feel a good start on the bench for the game against Watford. Bigger games ahead. We'll go with a safe option. We're going to go over August and see what we've got in September, and then we're going to go over deadline day. Just so you guys can see, so I can see really as well how we're going to do. We've got Watford at home before. I think this is the first group stage game against Basaksehir here. I'm also going to check the Europa League game. We've then got Huddersfield away, Southampton at Valley Parade in the Cup, and then finishing off the month with Newcastle at home. But if you didn't see August, been a mixed bag really. We lost 2-1 in the Community Shield. Lost 2-1 at Southampton, or against Southampton at Valley Parade. 2-1-all at the Emirates against Arsenal. Lost 2-1 against Brighton. I don't want to talk about that one in detail. Beat Sheffield Wednesday 4-0 at Hillsborough, and then beat Aston Villa 2-1 at Villa Park. So hopefully that's a start of something that will continue to be our push to the top four, really. We've gone from 17th to 12th with one win. Right, let's take a look at our Europa League group. I know we've got Basaksehir here, but who else have we got? We've got Stade Rennais, who might be the problem in this group, and then Michelin. We should be making it through there, like 100%. If we don't, I will be questioning this game. The other groups are Schalke, Porto, Olympiakos, and Lechia Gdansk, Hertha Berlin, Saint-Étienne, Ghent, and Galatasaray, Manchester United, BFC, Young Boys, Feyenoord, Molde, Gympie Mammoth, if you're watching. Our favourite teams are in the same Europa League group. Roma, Wolfsburg, Besiktas, and Lucerne, Southampton, AZ, Gimaresh, we'll just call him, and Sparta Praha, Fiorentina, Real Betis, Basel, and Athens, Lille, Genk, FCSB, and Rangers, Lazio, Ajax, Sturm Graz, and Rosenborg, Valencia, Braga, Liège, and PAOK, Villarreal, Slavia Praha, Celtic, and Rapid Vienna, and Sporting, Trabzonspor, Vitorul, and Groningen. So those are the Europa League groups. We know ours, we know everyone else's. Now let's get to the biggest transfers of the summer. I think the biggest one was Paulo Dybala, and it was Dybala. What rating will he be now? He'd be 90-something, won't he? He'd just be 90. 30 years of age as well. He's gone to Real Madrid. Oh, he's gone from Real Madrid to Paris Saint-Germain for 76.6 million. Just so you know how I do this, guys, before we go any further, I'm going down to 30 million or to the bottom of the list. I don't know. Whichever comes first. We've got Benfica selling Florentino, to Real Madrid for 70 million. He must be a good prospect. Oh, wow. Okay. They've overpaid definitely for him there. Guendouzi going from Arsenal to Atletico Madrid for 63.7 million. Andy Robertson going from Atletico Madrid to Paris Saint-Germain for 63.2 million. He's got to be 90-something as well. 89. His rating might be coming down. And McKenny going from Bournemouth to Chelsea for 63.2 million. He must be a decent prospect. He is. Fair enough then. Eder Militao going from Dortmund to Bradford City for 60 million. A purchase that he's slowly settling in, I think, but yet to see any real benefit from it. Kevin De Bruyne going from Real Madrid to Bayern Munich for 53.6 million. He's still going around the big clubs at 33 years of age. He's still 87 rated, so understandable why. Hermoso going from West Ham to Everton for 53.3 million. Brooks going from Bologna to Atletico Madrid. I believe he starts with Bournemouth in the career, but I can't remember. Christensen going from Atletico Madrid to Inter Milan for 53 million. Samuel Umtiti going from Bayern to West Ham for 53 million. Zagadou was the one I was thinking of signing, to be honest, but I don't think he grew as much as I wanted him to. He's now gone from Manchester United to Barcelona, so that's one defender less to deal with. He actually, I thought he grew a bit quicker than that. We've got Timothy Weah going from Hamburg to Leverkusen. What's his rating now? 83. Not too shabby. 49.1 million, I think I said there. Maxi Gomez going from Napoli to Liverpool for 48.8 million. Wolf going from Leipzig to Arsenal for 48.4 million. Roca going from Valencia to Lyon for 46.9 million. Anderson being transferred away from Spurs to Bayern for 46.7 million. And Dominic, I think it's Dominic Malin, isn't it? Danielle Malin, sorry, my bad. He's still looking decent. He's gone from Leverkusen to Wolfsburg for 46.6 million. Mukiele going from Leicester to Manchester United for 46.3 million. So they might have lost Zagadou, but they've got Mukiele And that's just as bad in my opinion. I think Rashica going from Piemonte Calcio to Arsenal for 46.1 million. Wendell going from Wolfsburg to Brighton. We came up against him and he was a bit of a prick, to be honest, for 46 million. Nkunku going from Milan to Valencia for 45.4 million. Kerrer, I think he might be quite high rating at this point. Maybe not, though, because he's only 45.2 million. He's gone from Paris Saint-Germain to Dortmund. Ben Chilwell gone from Spurs to Manchester United for 43.5 million. Fernando Torres. No, not Fernando. Who will it be? Ferran Torres. I don't know. I thought immediately Fernando Torres because of, you know, former Liverpool player. He's gone from Burnley to Spurs for 43.4 million. No wonder Burnley came with a high offer for Carbonero. That's where they got the money from. Jose Gaya going from Paris Saint-Germain to Spurs as well for 43 million. Lazio have sold Belotti to Everton for 41.1 million. Griezmann still moving around in his career as well. Gone from Barcelona to Piemonte Calcio for 40.8 million. How much is he now? Or what rating I should say? 85. Well, he has declined. Maybe not the best purchase there from Piemonte. Exposito going from Ibar to Roma for 40.1 million. Oblyakov. Don't know why I struggle with that. It's gone from CSK Moscow to Fiorentina for 37.8 million. Audrey Osola has been transferred from Barcelona. Oh, Bradford. Obviously, because it's a Korean mode, but like, why did that come to my brain? From Barcelona to Napoli, I should say, for 36.9 million. N'Golo Kante still moving about. Gone from Bayern to Everton for 36.9 million. He's now 33. Still 87 rated, though, but his form is poor. Knowing when, not like, when we come up against any of these guys, his forms will be poor. When we come up against them, they'll fucking be insane. Mary going from Leverkusen to Frankfurt for 36.8 million. Ruiz going from Sassuolo to Frankfurt for 36.6 million. Reece James going from Hertha Berlin to Southampton for 36.5 million. I can't remember offhand if this was the one that I loaned. My memory is awful. Anyway, Junior Firpo going from Leipzig to Paris for 36.5 million. Sanabria going from Atletico Madrid to Milan for 36 million. Reguilon has left Manchester United and he's gone to Leipzig for 36 million. Mönchengladbach have sold Silva. I think it's Andre Silva, right? Yeah, he's gone to Atalanta for 36 million. Mauro Icardi's left Everton for Villarreal for 36 million. 35.6 million there between Nottingham Forest and Sampdoria for Carvalho. I think Nottingham Forest now back down in the Championship from recollection, although I can't remember actually if they survived or not. I don't think they did. Grealish going from Crystal Palace to Atlanta for 34.5 million. Napoli selling Elmas to Atlanta for 34.4 million. Atlanta get a bit busy there. Didn't mean to click that. Bournemouth have sold Franco to Cologne, or Cologne, however you want to say it, for 32.7 million. Boubacar Kamara has gone from Man City to Lazio for 32.6 million. Quite a low price. And that's probably because he hasn't grown maybe as much as City or myself had expected, actually, to be honest. He's only 5'10 anyway, so he wouldn't have been a great centre back. Nuno Tavares has gone from West Ham to Mönchengladbach for 32.4 million. Isak gone from Hertha Berlin to Napoli. He was another one I was thinking of signing. And I mean, it still could be one that could be on the cards at some point. I don't know. Wilfred Ndidi going from Leicester to Real Madrid for 31.5 million. He's got some quite high rating. Only 84. Fair enough. Dagba going from Leicester to Hoffenheim for 31.2 million. Angelino, the newest of one Manchester club going to, well, one Manchester club player going to another Manchester club at some point in career mode. Obviously, he hasn't gone straight from City to Man United. He's gone from Leipzig to Manchester United. 31 million for Angelino, an interesting one. And we've reached the bottom of the page. So, I should have actually gone over just my business as well right at the end there. But we didn't really do much business. It was more selling than buying, to be honest. We bought Eder Militao for 60 million from Dortmund. We sold Fikayo Tomori to Deportivo Alaves for 20 million. We sold Vyacheslav Lebedev to Fenerbahce for 8.5 million. We sold Ethan Robinson to SPAL for 6 million. We sold William Lundberg to Gympie Malmö's favourite club, Feyenoord, for 3.9 million, I should say. I can't read. We sold Nicholas Cook to XL Muscron for 1.2 million. And we sold Frederick Eriksson. I think it was Frederick Eriksson. Yeah, it was. To Lugano for 1.05 million. Declan White's gone to Wigan for 770k. And Lindqvist has gone out to Villarreal on the loan. We can terminate that in a point if we need him. As well as Varenkov going out to Swansea on a loan. Mainly the reason I've done a lot of this with the youth players is because some of them weren't going to grow ever. And some of them were going to grow but maybe need to go somewhere else for a bit. Which is why I've done so many loan deals for them. We've still got $59 million to spend in January. That will probably all be put towards some pre-contract players that will maybe take us to the next level. If we're not already on the next level already, we should really be on the next level as it is with this team. This is solid. I thought my Henderson's still in goal. Let's put Lafont back in there. But of course, we've had a little bit of an upgrade in some players. Greenwood, the most notable right there. And Upi Meccano as well, I'm pretty sure, has been upgraded. Militar, I think, has gone up too. So that's going to be all involved in the squad report at the start of the next episode. But I hope you guys have enjoyed this episode of the Bradford City Career Mode. Finally getting our first Premier League win. It's about damn time. But I hope you guys have enjoyed, like I said, and I'll see you very, very soon for the next one where we take on our bogey team from last season. It is Watford. Bye for now.